just to try and build up the anticipation. Molly, did you send it?
Do you want me to step out there and ask if anyone else is coming in?
That was it.
Oh, that's your art.
Sorry, you're way ahead of me.
If you're coming in for the ISP presentations, we're about to begin.
Wow. Stampede coming. When I finish proud, I was so nervous.
The few, the proud, the loyal, the loving.
How is everybody today?
Warm.
Since I'm on live stream.
How many are left?
How many days? Oh, clothespins?
Clothespins.
I don't want to talk about clothespins. My life has been overrun by clothespins.
Wait a minute, you
I think there are like 15 left.
Are you still alive, Kendra?
She
is.
Oh, I was down in the photo lab with Caleb.
I heard
you
quantify
your
classy.
We're so alive. Either confirm or deny.
That statement.
I'm still bitter.
She just thought it was stuff. So she pulled the door. I pulled the door. Wow. Off of me.
Power of an elf.
Power of women.
I came down and scared. And Kate was standing in the front door without shoes on. I'm like, what are you doing? She's like, I had to run out of my office. I had no shoes on. I was like, well, okay.
I was pretty confused. Because I knew I had to sprint, so as we were circling around the table to get all the raisins in, I just kicked my shoes off.
Dedication.
I was getting ready. I've been training for this.
Is this how you train with the
tough butter? The first set of bow and arrows I see, I'm out of your Hunger Games.
All right, well, I'm going to get this going. Welcome to the 2018 ISP presentations. We have three presentations today with four presenters, and Leah Proctor is going to start us off. So, Leah, without further ado.
Hi, so good afternoon, everyone. This spring, I focused my ISP on voter education of Westover's upperclassmen. I decided to do this project because I was chosen to take the AP U.S. Government AP Comparative Politics online courses. And these courses really gave me an appreciation for democracy and government. I say democracy because many don't realize that it really is a privilege living in a country like the United States. I have often felt like Westover students don't comprehend politics and voting the way I think they should, and throughout my project, I have attempted to teach some basics on voter education. In terms of voter turnout amongst young people in the U.S., young people are the lowest percentage of people that actually go to the polls. We see a lot of political movements started by young people, but the voter turnout still isn't there. One of the main goals of my project was to be able to articulate and get Westover students to vote when the time came. And voting doesn't just mean big presidential elections, but congressional elections, Senate elections, governor, city council. I think you guys get the point. So before I could put together a video series, and I got the video series idea from Ben, because originally I was just going to write a research paper, I had to do research on what messages worked for teens and what wasn't so effective. I found that teens and college students got really bored when we start talking about the nitty-gritty, and even when you start just giving a whole bunch of facts, but rather focusing on the big ideas. Westover is also a school, so there wasn't, you can't spend a whole year and a half talking about solely politics and voter education because there just isn't the time, so really trying to get those big concepts out was something that I was working on. I also, in the course of the research, I also found that young people do register to vote. The problem is they just actually don't get to the polls, so post-registration is one of the biggest problems. And some obstacles include they don't have transportation to get to those voting polls. There's an intimidation about going and actually voting on the voting ballots, and just lack of knowledge based on what you're actually voting for. So that was just kind of a little summary. But from there, I made 6 scripts. And at first, I didn't really know what I wanted the videos to look like. I didn't want to just talk it up camera. So I sent out an email to some seniors, and I said, hey, how do you feel about filming with me? And I got an email back from Chaley, and she was like, Leah, I don't know anything about government. I don't know anything about politics. And I said, then you're going to be great for this. So from there, after I filmed videos, there's a lesson plan to go with each video to reinforce an idea that was talked about in the video. So I'm going to play the pilot video for you.
The Women's March, gun violence rallies, the Black Lives Matter movement, the 2016 presidential election. What do all of these have in common? Political involvement. Political involvement is the act of personal expression that allows one to participate in government in order to make change. Voting is what many consider one of the most frequent and regulated acts of political involvement. Good morning, everyone. My name is Leah. Welcome to Mornings with Leah. Today, I'll be discussing what voting is with my guest, Jibberly. Jibberly has 3 goals today: learning what voting is, why she should vote, and the impact of her vote. So let's get into today's video.
So Leah, I don't know what being politically active is like, and you mentioned that voting was one of the more regulated forms of political involvement. So what exactly is voting?
Voting is the act of going to the polls to express your support for a candidate or a law in the hopes that your vote will lead to some sort of political action.
Can you give me some examples?
When many voted for Obama in 2008, their vote signaled a vote for more employment and accessible health care for everyone. Voting can be exciting. Your vote could decide the difference between 2 presidential candidates, or it can influence new laws. In terms of voting in Westover's elections, my vote for the 2017-2018 heads of school was a vote for new dress code policies, and now I wear whatever I want for my talk show.
Okay, I see. Voting seems pretty important, but I don't know, Leah.
If having political power and deciding the state of affairs in government doesn't appeal to you, let me tell you why it is your responsibility to vote. As a citizen of a democracy, we are not only awarded civil liberties, but we are also given political responsibilities. It is your democratic duty as an American citizen to vote. Democratic duty is the responsibility to participate in democracy, which includes but is not limited to voting. The system of democracy fails when too many people don't do their job. If no one votes, then the few have a say over the many. I know we all have conspiracy theories over the Illuminati and other social orders, but I promise you, our political state would be so much better if people voted. The more people vote, the better our government can serve us. And who doesn't like to be served?
Well, as a Latinx woman, I haven't always felt properly represented, so why should I vote?
In order to see change in government, we must vote. You cannot complain about a system failing you if you have nothing to do with helping them. When the framers designed the Constitution, they left out a majority of Americans. Black people, non-landowning white men, women, Native Americans. Many people died over the right to vote. So remember that voting is a privilege, and a privilege that many still don't have because of where they live, their status of ex-convicts, or because they're not of age. If you don't vote, you're relinquishing the power to make a difference. Change is slow. And as young people, we all want instant gratification. But our system's not perfect. It cannot readily provide change overnight.
Okay, so I'll vote. But I don't feel like my classmates or my friends will. What can I do to spread the word?
When you vote, other people vote. It's like positive peer pressure. Think about when Rihanna's lingerie line or her makeup comes out and your friend gets it, then you want it because it's Rihanna and she's an icon. But more seriously, research shows us that the more your peers vote, the more you'll be influenced to vote. You're 18, most of you will be 18 soon, and whether you are able to vote in the U.S. or not, you all have a responsibility to stay engaged. Even if you are not able to vote here, it is worth understanding how decisions are made in the U.S.
I want to look up the president here tonight.
Alright, so I'll vote in the presidential election. That seems like enough. Because the presidency affects me a lot, right?
Yes and no. We tend to think the presidential election is the most important, but that's actually not the case. Some of the most important elections are local and state, and they can actually change policy pretty quickly.
Like what? I've never heard of such a thing.
So the New York Assembly and Senate made the rule that Uber couldn't operate in upstate New York, including Rochester, meaning if you don't have a ride to the mall, you're out of luck. By voting for those senators and assemblymen, you are voting for the laws those members put in place. And ultimately, those members decide how things are run.
Okay, I see what you're saying, but I'm still not sold on these local elections.
Okay, so don't just take my word for it. Let me give you the facts. Only 1 in 5 vote for local elections, which means your vote has an even bigger impact because you are deciding the people you want to represent your beliefs. If you vote, your local officials will be more responsive to your needs and the needs of your constituents. Meaning, if the water pipe on 3rd Avenue is busted and people on 3rd Avenue vote, the officials will be faster to fix the pipe because they want to be reelected. Because the people in your community vote. This also means when you call your congressman about a problem, they are more likely to be responsive.
Is that all local officials do? Answer calls about broken pipes?
No. They also have the power to control the quality of city public schools, the power to hold the police accountable, public transportation, and more.
Okay, so I will be voting in more than just the presidential election.
I know that I just gave you a lot of information. I know keeping up with the times at West Sober is hard, but please understand, I'm teaching you about voting and civil service because when you don't vote, you are succumbing to the rules and policies of other people. I promise we're going to walk through this process together, and one vote at a time, we'll make a change. I want to give a special thank you to Jimberly for coming out to my show, and by doing that, you get this crown. Thank you so much for coming to the show. As always, enjoy your activity and stay woke.
Shelby, Kathy, when I was doing this project, time allotment for class meetings was, you know, kind of something that needed to be figured out before I could actually go in and decide what topics to choose. A big shout out to Carolyn. It's been a long process of getting this together. There's been a lot of steps. It was touch and go for a little bit, but it's really something that I'm proud of. Hopefully Westover girls will enjoy looking at something like this, or even someone, if someone can continue my work, that would be really awesome. I want to thank everyone that I did a video with, so Scott, Jerilee, Gulse, Maddie, Meredith, and just everyone who supported me throughout this project. So, questions?
Where is your curriculum going to be residing? Is it in... with the Raisin Center, or?
I haven't quite decided. Right now, the lesson plans are kind of all with, they're all gonna be with the class team, so it's gonna be, it'll be either 3 or 4 junior year, and then 2 senior year, just kind of depends. And then the curriculum is, the first one is this one, so like, why should I vote? The second one talks about the three branches of government and how your vote impacts the three branches of government. The third one talks about political ideology. The fourth one talks about picking a candidate. You also have one.
Parties?
Yeah, political parties. And then the final one is actually registering to vote. So.
That's great.
That's
awesome.
Thank you,
Lee. Thank you.
Next up is Kimberly and Dulcinea, who did a joint project.
You should just be able to put the mouse all the way at the bottom.
Which we conducted interviews with some people that we knew and some strangers on their how they feel being people of color in America, or people being from other cultures being taken away from there and living in America, or being from.
Yeah, so our project was inspired by like our lives, basically. We're both women of color, but we kind of have different paths, like, but still being women of color. So I'm an immigrant of sorts, and my family has been a family of immigrants for a certain time in different places. And
I'm first gen, so everybody in my family was born in the Dominican Republic and moved here. But I was born here, so I have a bit of I'm Dominican American, whereas they're just Dominican. So I have a really different experience than they do.
So we thought we're going to interview people with the same set of questions that walk different paths. So I was in charge, you would say, of the African diaspora community. So when I lived here, there were a lot of friends that lived in D.C., Maryland, New York, New Jersey, and I kept in touch with a lot of them, and some of them returned home. So when I went home for spring break, I interviewed them about their experience as African diaspora, which I shared with them, actually, most of the time. But we used the same set of questions that German people saw.
All the people that I interviewed, which included Dominicans, Dominican Americans, and Trinidadian Americans. So we just went about that. But we also interviewed a lot of other people, but their interviews didn't make the cut for calling for photography.
I can scroll through.
So basically, we took these interviews, we listened to them, transcribed them, and then Jibberly wrote poems out of the interviews that made the cut, and then I took all of the interviews and all of the transcriptions and made a photo series out of them.
Stepmother, and I had no idea about her being from Trinidad or how she felt about being from there. So my interview with her was just like really, not mind-blowing, but really like, oh, I had no idea that you felt like this. So a short ode to the Trinidad I never loved. Trini never taught me much. She didn't teach me how to be a woman or leave my home or love my wife. Trini ripped itself away from me, like the way Mama's realty left at my nose, pushing and pulling. Trini was never home to me. America spelled out opportunity, even though it came with the cost of leaving Trini behind. Maybe I ripped myself away from Trini. America gave me love, gave me freedom, gave me real life. But Trini, I don't know too much about her anymore. It feels like she's an old friend, maybe more of a would-be lover, a flame that burned out before it even started, before I was able to get used to her. When Mama talks about her, all I can remember is her roti. America gave me no sense of belonging or stability in my sense of self. I wish Mama had given Trini another chance. I wish I could give Trini another chance. I wish roti wasn't all I remembered from the home that was never mine. Quote number two is my best friend, Jaylene. I interviewed her, and I found out more about how she feels being Dominican-American. Invading spaces is not something I think twice about or blink too hard over. Invading spaces not meant for me has become a regular part of my day. Wash, rinse, repeat, and walk into that no man's land of who am I supposed to be today? I wake up and smell the barrio I was never a part of. I hear mommy's stories of La Isla, but they always sound too distant to me. I inhabit two worlds inches away from colliding and splitting me in half. But I am frozen. Frozen in time, frozen in mind. I can't move to the white side or the right side, and my black keeps creeping out. But my tongue doesn't agree with the enyas and the rolling R's of my rolling mind. Who am I? I wish I could patch up the holes burned into mommy's sueño americano, but most times I find myself wishing I were less of a mulatto mutt. I wish I could find more of a common ground. But mommy always told me to be proud of la isla que no me quieres. The disconnect I feel between americana y dominicana is so present. It wraps around me like broken cords, waiting to shock me into some sort of submission. I'm sick of waiting to feel whole. I keep thinking that if I just choose, I'll be happy, but nowhere feels right for me. This third poem is about me. So. I don't know who to belong to anymore. A veces, sometimes, I think, que yo debo de ser otra. I should be another. I should pick a side. Debo sentir patria. I should feel pride. I should feel proud of myself, but siento como que el aire no me alcanza. I feel like I don't have enough air to fill my lungs. I don't have the strength or the wisdom or the character or the character to be the girl, mommy, mom, always wanted me to be. I've been trying. Tratando de sangrar los colores de mi bandera, trying to bleed the colors of my flag. But the wounds always heal themselves up. Tratando de ser una dominicana, trying to be a Dominican in an America that makes me feel as though tengo que elegir un lado, that I have to pick a side. I'm black, I'm proud. Soy dominicana, soy orgullosa. I'm Dominican, I'm proud. But something always holds me back from truly viviendo como una niña de padre y madre, living like a girl raised by Dominican parents. But I've been rising up. Me siento, I feel, like a woman now. Soy alguien con, I am someone with, value and orgullo. Pride. I'm dangerous. Y estoy esperando el momento, and I'm waiting for the moment to let it be known.
So Jaberly wrote this one on me based off of my interview.
Munirgwandakas Randan means everything to me. Simonia Vita is my lifeline. The thing that keeps me going when I move around in this space is not made for me. Because I can't omit the opportunities afforded to me in America by mom and dad, I can't forget the constant
shape shifting.
I'm grown to be too good at. Living in America makes me forget about the pricking stares from the girls too ashamed of their desires. Looking down on me, though I've always had my held my head up higher than most. But I will not trade this life for any other. Randa gives me a sense of self. She keeps me grounded and level-headed. Always in my moving ground. Never having to look left or right to find who I am.
So if you couldn't tell, a lot of the interviews or a lot of the poems have a pretty recurring theme of, I don't know who I am, I'm kind of like trying to pick a side, such and such.
And this is the final image of the series, and the Nachinu Churishi Musurishi, that means nothing is easy under the sun, and my mom is always telling me that, you know, let me complain to her, she's like, you only feel peace. By your standards, you only feel peace when you're dead. So, you know, she always says that to me, and I guess it keeps me humble.
So we wanted to say thank you to a lot of people.
Shout out to Ben, Shelby, Kathy, Eric, our ISP advisor who's not here right now. Shout out to him for letting me do my thing, not putting a lot of pressure on me or to really do work, because this is kind of like we chose to do work that isn't, you can't just do it because there's a deadline, you know, there's a lot of things we have to feel to, you know, make it happen. I wanted to give a shout out to my models, so Mira and Lodi, Zoe, Meredith, and Kara made all of this happen, and of course the white sheet. and we wanted to thank our interviewees.
Yeah, but they're not here. So,
do you all have any questions about what we said / share video?
Oh, I was just wondering, how did you guys kind of correlate as far as like you writing it and then you taking the card? How did that kind of meld?
Kind of happened. Like, we knew what we wanted to do, and so together.
I guess we're like, were you more inspired by the poetry, or did you take the photo first, or how did that work?
We didn't work together on either part. It's not, like, we worked together in the sense she would write, I would read, say whatever I think. I would shoot, she would see, she would, you know, give her input, but it was never like, what we inspired each other in our, with our interviews.
Yeah.
That was our common ground, the interviews, that's where all of it came from.
Okay. I was going to ask a question about the process as well, but is there anything more in terms of the process of picking your models for your photos?
Actually, when Mira and the Woodney came in, I had to be like, this is not a diversity shoot. Like, yes, this is about culture and like clashing of cultures, but I didn't pick you because you're Indian. Like, that's not, you know, what it is. I chose people based on who I thought would fit the image better. Like, I don't know about other photographers, but when you see something in your head that like you already see someone who's going to fit the picture, and that's basically how I pick people. And also, I've noticed, I haven't seen them in other photo products, and I didn't know why. So, like, I'm wondering, why don't other people pick you? You're studying, you know, so that's why, that's how I selected models.
What did you learn that you didn't expect to?
From the people that I interviewed, especially like my best friend, when I interviewed her, I knew that she felt that way, but when she started going more in depth about feelings like really in between and not feeling like she can connect to anyone racially, it made me feel like, oh my god, like, I'm A, not the only one, and B, I had no idea that you felt this way.
I think the only, like, this happened yesterday when they really asked me,
like in the midst of my interview, she asked me, if you had to live your life another way, what would you do? You know, based on all the experiences you've lived, all the places you've been, whatever. And I couldn't come up with anything I would change, to be honest with you. Like, there are a lot of things I don't know, appreciate about the way I've grown up, per se, but I wouldn't change anything. You know, she asked me, would you change when you came to America? No, I would not. I can't think of a better time, maybe because I haven't experienced an alternative time to pick from, but I do appreciate every single experience, good or bad. That surprised me because I thought I could come up with a list of things I would change in a heartbeat, but I couldn't think of one thing.
Because one of the questions on the interviews was, would you live anywhere else? Or, like, if you could, where would you?
And also, I didn't have an answer to that because I've lived so many places that it's like, I'm not one of those people, like, I do have a home base, Rwanda, but it's not like a permanent home base. I don't have an attachment to like places as much as other people may.
She said Paris, but was like for no particular reason. Just
I liked it there when I went.
I was just wondering if you want to expand this and continue working on this beyond Westover, if you would expand to other communities or
I mean, we wanted to, like, go out to a bunch of different places to conduct these interviews so we can have, like, a real, like, melting pot of people, because I noticed that when I was interviewing people, like, most of the people came from the same place, and so I was like, oh my god, I have no material. But we would definitely try to have more people from different places.
Yeah, I wish we had started this earlier, because if we started it earlier, like, what could it be, a book? You know, really, like, it could really be, like, a book about these experiences, because these are people's lives, you know, it's not, we're not talking about trees right now, we're not talking about something, you know, it's people's lives and the complexity of all of that.
Thank you.
When I realized last year how much waste the Westover community produces each day. Setting aside my horror when I realized a couple weeks ago that the Westover community goes through 2,000 paper cups a week, I have noticed the need to try and create a system that would drastically reduce the amount of waste sent to landfill by composting as much of our dining hall waste as possible. Composting takes advantage of natural cycles of decomposition of organic matter by feeding decomposers organic wastes, in this case our compostable dining hall waste, and providing as optimum of conditions as possible to speed up the process. Overall, my goals were the following. One, to find a convenient and simple way to collect compostables and transport them to a well-maintained compost heap. Two, to educate the Westover community on how and what to compost. Three, integrate and make sustainable the system by creating a work project or club that would collect the compost and maintain the correct conditions for the heap. And four, build an efficient and easily maintained composting area close enough to both the dining hall and the student garden to allow ease of transporting waste to the heap and compost to the garden. To start, I researched compost and the conditions required to make it successful. Compost is made possible by the organisms that thrive on decomposing matter. Therefore, compost is a living organism in itself that requires food, air, water, and other basic necessities. Decomposers any of the little bugs from bacteria and single-celled fungi to mushrooms, earthworms, and insects need water, but not so much that the compost remains soupy. Warmth, but only enough for the decomposers to remain healthy and productive without losing too much water. Matter to eat in the proper ratio of carbonaceous and to nitrogenous wastes, and oxygen. Oxygen is especially important to producing compost because aerobic decomposition, simply meaning decomposition where oxygen is present, naturally produces carbon dioxide, while anaerobic decomposition, which doesn't use oxygen, generally produces methane as a byproduct, along with the occasional alcohol, acid, and some sulfur compounds. So you all probably know about carbon dioxide, but like about the dangers of the greenhouse gas. But its cousin methane is 20 times more powerful at retaining heat in the Earth's atmosphere and contributing to climate change. And it is also inaccessible to organisms, making it very difficult to get rid of without just like, burning it. With optimum conditions, compost produces little methane because aerobic decomposition will occur instead of anaerobic decomposition. Plus, it won't stink that way. But how does composting help the planet? I mean, gas! It produces greenhouse gases. Well, composting reduces the strain put on landfills from the increasing quantities of trash we produce, reduces methane emissions from compostable wastes that would otherwise decompose anaerobically within landfills, and reduces the amount of material sent to trash-to-energy incinerators that, though they generate electricity, produce potentially hazardous ash waste and emit carbon dioxide, particulate matter, and other air pollutants that damage human and environmental health. The other most important factor in engineering my compost system was the need for a balance of carbon and nitrogen in the materials added to the compost. Luckily, by providing the bowls in the dining hall at two tables and examining the composition of the wastes collected, I have confirmed that the correct ratio of carbon to nitrogen will be maintained easily in this system, owed almost entirely to the paper napkins that provide much-needed carbon to the mainly nitrogenous remainder of the waste. So my sample size is very low, so if that ratio ever gets off, I might have to ask the maintenance crew for some leaves. But, you know. So throughout my research, I always had a visual in my head of what I really wanted to build to make composting work here. So, though there is a compost heap behind the LBD, very few people know it even exists, and it is too far removed from the dining hall and the garden to really get much use. The current heap is also not optimal to use indefinitely, because once it is filled, the compost will take a long time to decompose, and it wouldn't be able to move. And it is very difficult to turn the compost in that area the way it is, so I would need to find another way to do that. So essentially, I drew the following thing, and this is my plan. It's going to be built, I hope, on the old tennis courts next to the EAC garden so that the compost will be easily accessed for fertilizer. Because the compost will be on the tennis courts, I will need to provide it with some shade and prevent overwatering from rain and drying out from evaporation, thus the roof. So the roof will also reduce the problem of leachate runoff, which is materials that are dissolved in water from the compost that can fertilize plants but could also lead to eutrophication, which is basically algae blooms that cause lots of problems in bodies of water when too many nitrogen compounds enter the waterways. So because having a roof would divert the rainwater away from the compost, it would prevent the compost getting overwatered, essentially, and then there wouldn't be enough water to actually seep out of the compost and then enter the stream and go to the pond and make the pond even more covered with algae. So then my next thought was that if I were to build something that just filled up with waste like the old one does, I wouldn't really be able to keep this going indefinitely because as soon as the compost filled up, I'd have to wait a while for everything to decompose. So to remedy that problem, I decided to build the structure with multiple stalls. So essentially, I would fill one and then start like completely and then go to the next one and start adding to it. And then as we go, the first stall would start really decomposing. And then by the time the second one is full, the first one might be finished decomposing. So it would be usable by then, and then it's easier to maintain. And I figured that, I also figured that if I built something so big, I could kind of finagle it to make it more specific to what the garden has to offer also, because obviously there's no good source of running water near the garden, which has been a problem for people trying to water the plants, so I decided to add a gutter to the edge of the roof that would catch water and feed it into a rain barrel to collect water for both watering the plants in the garden and the compost if it gets too dry. There's no wear on the tennis courts to store any garden tools, and maintaining compost uses some of the same tools, so naturally I added hooks and a cabinet to the design. Hooks to hold the tools, so you keep hearing me say all these wonderful things about saving the environment by composting, but I also keep saying the word sustainable. How can this compost idea ever be sustainable if I'm about to graduate? Never fear, because we have work projects here. My hope is that I will maintain the compost by setting up a work project for one or two students to do throughout the year or throughout the term. I don't really know how they're going to work next year, if the schedule is changing. I doubt that it's going to change much. But my hope is that I could talk to the sustainability coordinator for next year to supervise a compost work project. I have the outline written up. It's what's being projected. But essentially, a couple of students would be responsible for emptying the compost bowl on each dining room or dining hall table into a central bin that would then be brought to the heap once or twice a week by the students or by maintenance if we end up with a lot of waste. It depends. And then the students would be tasked with going down to the compost heap once or twice a week and turning each of the stalls of waste to help aerate the compost and make it work faster. I'm very excited to see what comes of all of these ideas. This is the rest of the I'm really excited to see what comes, even if I never get to build this thing. It's just good. It's fun to know that Westover has the capability to take some of these steps towards reducing our impact on the environment. I would love to see a time when composting is the norm and no one even uses disposable cups anymore. But for now, I'm happy to just visualize the day when we finally embrace managing our effects on the environment here. So thank you very much and happy composting.
How will how is the garden going to be sustained as well?
That I haven't gotten a good thing about because I've been focusing so much on the compost, but I really hope that whoever is sustainability coordinator next year will keep that going. I've been meaning to try and get a way of really organizing, scheduling everything so that we know, when plants are going in, who's taking care of them, because that's always been troubling in the past, especially, because I've had the greenhouse work product for so long, so every time someone tries and starts seeds, if no one comes in and waters them regularly, and I forget to go in one time, they'll always die, so that's happened to me a couple of times, and I always feel bad, but I really want to make sure that I can talk to whoever's going to keep organizing that about being really organized so that there's like, I don't know, a spreadsheet that says like, okay, tomatoes are going in on May 5th and then we're going to harvest them hopefully by this time or whatever. But that's, I don't know, it's hard to, yeah, I'm not totally sure yet.
Did you, when you did the collections, did you take into account how much waste the dining hall itself produces?
That was a good question. I started, one of the first things I did was I met with Andrea, the woman who runs the kitchen, and basically what they do in the kitchen is that they have all of their own, like all of the scraps, so like all of the onion skins and orange peels and stuff like that they produce in the kitchen, and what they do essentially is they they collect it all, they weigh it so that they know how much they're using, so that for the administration company thing. And then what they do is they give, there are two different staff members who have chickens. So they give all of the vegetable scraps and stuff like that to the people who have chickens to feed to their chickens. So that's what happens to all of that. So I don't really get to be involved with the stuff that the kitchen does, mostly because the company is really like bogging down on what, like they're really particular on what the kitchen itself is supposed to do with their specific waste. So I try to focus on just the stuff that the dining hall, like the eaters, are producing, just the food waste.
Is there a risk of bears and other animals if it's not enclosed?
That is a potential problem. I do have a plan for. So I didn't draw them because it would have been hard to see like in, but I'm hoping to basically put doors that latch on each of those areas. I just didn't try those so you can see in. But that's especially if there are problems with pests and things like that. But it will be enclosed in the tennis court, which isn't entirely enclosed anymore. But
and tennis court is a whole thing.
I was going to say, we've never had a bear come to bother our compost, and we're right in the woods. So.
Right. Well, didn't you see one in your dumpster?
Derek did, yeah.
They
yeah.
have dumpsters, they don't need compost.
I know, I guess so.
That's right.
That's what Derek says.
Remember, there's no meat products in composting. So.
Right.
There's no meat
things.
Bears.
Depending on, I know, but depending on what they're smelling or what they're eating, mm-hmm. It's going to be good stuff for that.
Any other questions?
Thanks. Well, a big thank you to all four presenters for a very successful ISP this year. Thank you so much.
Can I get a picture of the four of you guys tomorrow?
Oh, no worries. I'm sure you're okay.